Every day the Bank of Hays is building better ways.
Locally owned and managed, the Bank of Hays strives every day to build better ways for banking locally. That is what it means to be your hometown community bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Building better ways, the Bank of Hays.
My name is Erin Renard, and I am the director of this year's Children's Halloween Concert with the Hays Symphony. I've been in theater probably, I've probably had over 50 productions under my belt, maybe more. I've done theater since I was in high school myself and all through college, and then after college I just continued on. And then I became a director of theater, and I'm currently on the faculty at Barton Community College and Fort Hays State University. I've been the theater director in both places, and I'm pulling back a little bit and just focusing on a few projects that I like to do. The Children's Halloween Concert is one of those. Well, this is the third year they're doing the children's concert with the Hays Symphony, and the idea started as a way to get children interested in classical music and exposed to classical music.
Hello, my name is Shah Sadikov. I'm the music director of the Hays Symphony Orchestra, as well as I'm the violin and viola professor at Fort Hays State University. Hays Symphony Orchestra is the oldest orchestra in Kansas. It's 105 years old. We have an amazing combination of members here. On one hand, we have people from the Fort Hays State University, the faculty and students. On the other hand, we have community members that are big lovers of music. And the third group is the professionals that come from all over Kansas. We bring people from Kansas City, from Lawrence, from Wichita, and Salina, and sometimes even from the Missouri side. This is a special concert for all of us. Since so many different groups are involved in one project. In contrast to what we do usually with our concerts, where we have the orchestra only and then maybe a soloist or something that we are producing for that particular concert. In this particular project is children actors and community theater members and the orchestra, and it all comes together in such tremendous energy, and the output is fantastic. We started rehearsals this week, and it started on a very high note, so it's promising to be fantastic. Concert on Sunday. It started with 3 years ago. Our marketing director Kathy Drapkin and I were speaking about bringing back the children's concert that they've done in the past before I came. And for this year, Kathy and I spoke about what specific thing we want to do, and she asked me to choose the music, and I thought about some of the great examples from orchestral repertoire, and of course Stravinsky's Firebird is one of the most famous, and it has the perfect storyline for children. It's a tough piece for orchestra, it's very challenging, and kudos to our members in the orchestra that have taken the challenge and doing a fantastic job. The narration side came from Catherine Trishman is a playwright based in Hays and great friend of ours. And she agreed to, this is her second time this year, agreed to write a storyline to the music. Originally, this music is written as a ballet. So there is a storyline, but it's not spoken, it's danced. And you perceive the story through watching the dance. Here we are combining and dancers and actors and spoken line through narration, which is narrated by Brenda Mather.
My name is Catherine Trishman, and I am the playwright of this new adaptation of The Firebird. I've been a professional playwright for over 15 years, and I've had plays produced all over the country, three plays off Broadway, internationally, so all over the world, really, which has been a wonderful career to have, even living here in Hays, Kansas. This is the second play, though, that I have written for the Hays Symphony Orchestra. And it's a great pleasure to write a piece for orchestra and quite different from the plays that I normally write.
Oftentimes as a director, I get creative license. And if I'm directing a full-length musical or a full-length play, the playwright is either deceased or out of contact or both, right? So in this case, I actually have the playwright with me at rehearsals. And sometimes I often will look over at Catherine and think, am I going the right direction, or am I going to be allowed to go this direction? Is this within your original concept, or am I pushing it by introducing something different? But she's great to work with, and we can discuss things, and we get along great. And so I appreciate it. She's a professional, and I'm lucky to be able to work with her.
I was living on the East Coast when I first launched my career. But then my husband, Dr. Carl Miller, got a job in the philosophy department at Fort Hays State University, so we moved out here. And, you know, in the age of the internet, it's not so difficult to be a writer living on the Great Plains. I write from home, and then I travel all over the country for various productions.
We've had a very good time with Catherine and Aaron this summer when we got together, including Kathy, of course, and spoke about how we want to present the storyline and which musical parts are effective and where should the narration go, the storyline, with that music. And I learned a lot from that experience, and I loved bringing to life a project that is still in the embryo form, you know, if so to speak. It's still there in your head, you know, or here. And then you start working on it and it comes to life.
Well, I always work with directors. So directors don't always work with playwrights because often the playwright is dead. However, as a living playwright, I'm always working with directors, and that's one of the reasons that I write dramatic literature instead of other kinds of literature, because I love the collaboration. I love bouncing ideas off other people. I love asking other people questions when I'm stuck. I'm a writer who's an extrovert, so I love that collaboration. Well, it's interesting. The Firebird is, in some circles, a very well-known piece of music, and it's traditionally done as a ballet. So in some ways, there wasn't really a pre-existing script for me to draw from. There was a pre-existing story, which is a little bit different. So I knew what events needed to happen, but I really created my own lyrical language to tell the story. It's fundamentally a fairy tale, an old Russian fairy tale, and I tried to infuse it with a little bit of my own original lyricism and sense of excitement and darkness and magic. I listened to the music while I was writing. So I would listen to the music and pause it, and then I would write a bit, and then I would listen to the music and pause and write, and then I would go back and revise and make the language as muscular and interesting and appropriate to each musical measure. So it was much more like writing poetry than like writing a play. We have so many working parts. We have the symphony, we have child actors, we have a wonderful young dancer, Brooke Racky, contributing this year. Lighting, we have a narrator, a costumer, there are so many different moving parts to this piece. But luckily we have a very experienced director at the helm, and that makes a lot of difference.
This is only the second time I've worked with a full symphony on stage. Typically, the orchestra is in the pit, and they come in maybe the last 2 weeks of rehearsal. So this orchestra, the symphony, is on stage. We only get 3 rehearsals with the symphony before we go up. So it's quite a bit of difference between, say, a traditional musical theater and a symphony with actors performing in front. Also, there's less space to perform, and there's really less room for error. I really enjoy working with the kids. They're adorable. I deal with college students all day, so it's kind of fun to come to rehearsal and deal with students who are just in the moment. They say whatever's on their mind. There's no passive-aggressive here. And I just adore them. They're really full of energy. Some of the challenges are just being able to keep their focus for long periods of time. Rehearsals are not the most exciting. Sometimes it's boring where they have to stand around. And also to expose them to some different type of characterization, some movements, things like that that they possibly have never experienced before. But the children are great.
The kids were amazing. They all were ready to go and super excited and prepared their parts very well, and when we had a first run through, it almost was perfect. So we had very little to fix. That's why I said that we started on a very high note. So if the quality is already very high in the first rehearsal, then the final product will be just amazing.
My name is Alyssa Deccan, and I am the choreographer for the Firebird. My main job is to work with the Firebird herself, which is also one of my students, Brooke Racky. She kind of fell within the age range that they were looking for, and Brooke also is a student that catches on very quickly, and she also is super theatrical in her face, so I thought she'd be perfect for the role.
Hi, my name is Brooke Racky. I will be playing the Firebird in the Firebird production, and I am a magical bird that finds this prince in a forest, and I help come and save it. And if you come and watch it, I also do some dances in there that you might see. I've been dancing since I was about 6 and a half-ish. And then I used to live somewhere else and I danced there when I was 2, and then I stopped. But I'm really glad I started dancing again when I was 6 and a half, because it really is my passion. I've never danced with live music before, or like music with no words, so that's really challenging.
One of Brooke's solos is 3 minutes long, and we are used to our solos here at our studio for our competition routines being between like 1:40 to 2 minutes, so a 3 minute long solo for one individual was pretty difficult.
I'm looking forward to seeing how people react to it, and I really love working with all the kids, and I'm excited to do it on stage with them.
People might think I am biased about it, but in fact I just read another article, scientific article, that is proving the point again and again how music and how arts are important for the development of the young generation. You know, them being involved with music or with arts is not necessarily, it's expected from them that they will become professional musician, professional artist. What is important is that they learn as much as they can from the art. Meanwhile, it develops not only their emotional senses, right? Art is emotion, but it also helps them develop their physical abilities, because playing an instrument is a physical thing. It's like sports people that keep themselves in shape by practicing every day. Same thing is in music. Also, music is mathematics. It's so logical, and it helps to develop logical thinking. At the end of the day, it makes them sensitive people, you know, and more sensitive kids are more compassionate they are, and they grew up being very nice people in general. That's what arts are for, and I absolutely believe it is empirical to teach in schools and maybe outside of school arts.
being involved in dance, in any dance or any theatrical program, teaches kids a lot more than just those things, dance and theater. It teaches them to have confidence. It teaches them like communication skills. Like, a lot of kids are used to being on stage and in front of people, so I think that helps later on down the line with jobs and interviews and stuff like that.
Interestingly enough, when I was a young dancer, back in elementary school, one of the first ballets that I danced in was the Firebird, in fact. So I launched my career in the arts as a monster in the Firebird, so it's really fun to see my children doing it. The arts give us great pleasure. They show us how to live well. They bring pleasure to our lives. They challenge our minds. And more than anything that I want for my children is to give them a wonderful arts education so that they can live their life not just materially well, but in an intellectually enriching way.
And clearly, I am an advocate for the arts and education. I've been in the education and the arts for the past 30 years. I feel that children respond to different things. Sometimes children respond to sporting events and sports, which is very big out here. But there's a whole bunch of children that respond to music and dance and visual arts, performing arts. And we really have to have a strong base for those creative types as well. It's really going to benefit everyone. Is everyone going to be great at the arts? No. But the arts is good for every person.
Yeah, I have to be not hard.
Once upon a time, in a forest dark and deep, an evil sorcerer named Ploshy crept into the wood. And with all the power of his terrible craft, he bound all living things to his will. He gathered the rabbit gentle and the badger true, the deer solemn and wily fox, the hedgehog and voles, wolves and chipmunks, and turned them all into monsters. As for the humans living there, he petrified them, turning all to stone. Except for princesses lovely. Taken with their beauty and grace, Kashi let them live, but imprisoned them in the forest so they could never leave. There they grew more beautiful with time, though they had no one but themselves for company. They gathered nuts brown and berries ripe, and one brave girl, Irenka, shot down the birds that flew over the forest enchantment so they might eat. Except for the rare, magical firebird, who Irenka was wise enough to spare. One night dark, when all the other creatures were sleeping, Kashi gathered all his awful strength and cast an incantation vial. He inserted his soul, evil, into a single golden egg. As long as this egg stayed whole, he would die never, and his reign terrible would shadow the wood forever. Prince Ivan was told not to enter the forest, for things dark and vile lived there, the villagers said. But Ivan was a hunter brave and could not resist the brilliant plumage of the birds flying the trees over. One morning he entered the wood, intent on catching one of these birds rare. As soon as he saw her, Ivan knew the firebird was no ordinary creature. She had all the characteristics of a bird: wing, beak, claw, and yet she glittered in the wood dark like the sun over the sea sparkling. Ivan had to have her for his collection.
Dizzy.
to dance. She kept her spirits high by spinning around the forest, much to the delight of her sisters. Rose was an excellent storyteller and spun tales from the shapes she saw in Copse's shadow. Laura made the most delicious cordial from fruit she gathered in the forest, raspberries, mulberries, peaches, and quince. Genevieve sang a soprano of such sweet lilty, it made the birdsong fade from memory. Marta, the youngest, could read the moon and stars and kept track of their calendar. But it was Erenka that caught Ivan's eye, for it was clear from the way she held her bow and strode on thigh strong through the thicket. She was a mighty huntress, and as Erenka trailed behind her sisters, tracking the birds in the sky, Ivan took stride beside her. But Kashi would never let this happen.
Thank you.
Once Kashi was asleep deep, the Firebird led Ivan to the ancient black gum tree, where the golden egg containing Kashi's immortality lay hidden. Ivan lifted the thing evil over his head and cracked it open upon his knee. Kashi awoke with a start and felt his life force drain away. floating down the river out of his reach. His soul writhed like a twisted root on the forest floor. Then he sunk into himself and disappeared forever. The spell was broken. A new day dawned. The monsters returned to their animal selves. The rabbit Mary waved greeting with his furry ear. The deer gentle resumed her lapping. The fox and badger made friends, and the vole dug deep in the sharp dirt, exhuming shoots and roots with his nose. The wolf circled the copse of trees in a dance and kept sheathed his daggers. The chipmunk ate nuts brown from Laura's outstretched hand. The invisible shackles holding the princesses shattered, and they stood free in the shade of leaf-crowned trees, giggling, babbling, laughing. They frolicked through the woodland like honeybees swarming.
Thank you.
day the Bank of Hays is building better ways.
Locally owned and managed, the Bank of Hays strives every day to build better ways for banking locally. That is what it means to be your hometown community bank. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. Building